Secretary Salalima, the officers and the personnel of the DICT, and its attached agencies, PA RJ Jacinto, our officers of the national of various telecommunications companies, and colleagues, friends and colleagues, and our friends from the media, good morning, everyone. Thank you for giving us the chance to present the situation, a situation on the Philippine regulatory situation on telecommunications. So let's go to the first step. Please allow me to give you a lay of the land of the Philippine telecommunications industry by giving you a bit of statistics. The population of the Philippines right now is around 110 million, but the number of active SIM cards to date is around 130 to 140 million. This means that there are more active SIM cards in the market than the number of people. Of these active SIM cards, 98% are prepaid and only 3% is postpaid. There is almost a 50-50 split between feature phones and smartphones in the market at the moment. But it might be worthy to note that smartphones are steadily on the uptake given their competitive pricing now. With this, you can imagine that the industry is going towards data and internet as it steadily veers away from voice and text service. At this time, please allow me to report on the telco's quality of service. For voice, mobile, tests were done from October 2016 to January of 2017 in Metro Manila. Please note that the December results were basically tests done along EDSA. An increase in average throughput is due to the operation of the 700 MHz base stations installed in existing cell sites. As regards block call rate, results should not be higher than 4%. You would also notice that Smart is undergoing a network transformation and operation and upgrading. Kaya po kung mapapansin niyo, they are improving but medyo nagkakaroon pa po ng konting time, ano? That also happened to Globe 2 to 3 years ago when they were doing their network transformation. For fixed broadband, we tested for fiscal year 2016 till February 2017 in various areas in Mandaluyong, Makati, San Juan, Manila, Parañaque, and Quezon City. These are various may households, institutions, hospitals, kung ano po ang pumayag. The average download speed you will see in the results is the percentage of the subscribed broadband speed plan. For example, if the subscribed broadband plan is 10 Mbps, the average download speed for PLDT is 7.917 Mbps. For fixed broadband in city halls, ito po mga next slides that we will show, we did it for the Telecom Summit. Bali, kumuha po kami ng mga iba't ibang institutions and iba't ibang areas for purposes of the Telecom Summit. For fixed broadband in city halls, or mga munisipyos po natin, out of 32 samples, an average of 60% of the subscribed broadband speed plan was measured. We also visited public schools for fixed broadband. Out of 58 samples, an average of 81.6% of the subscribed broadband speed plan was measured. For fixed broadband for household, well, for households po, we had quite a difficulty in doing tests because most of the connections are in the bedrooms of the people. So we have a problem with privacy and security. And because the tests take around 2 hours, most of the people that we approach decline. In this case, only subs of Sky Cable accepted to participate in the test. Kaya sila lang po ang may results. Among city halls, public schools, and private households for fixed broadband, the average download speed for samples in city halls is the lowest. Now, we also wrote villages. Ito, iba't iba pong villages around Metro Manila. Out of the 9 villages that we requested permission from para po pumasok, only one has responded positively to date. The date of testing is still determined. Ayaw po magpapasok, Lumalabas po ng ating po mga villages and private subdivisions, ang kanila po mga homeowners association ay ayaw po magpapasok inside their villages. Sabi po ng aming mga engineers, we don't have results for villages. Actually, sabi ko po, yun pong hindi pagpapasok sa atin is a result. Makikita po, that's a reflection of yun pong attitude ng po mga homeowners association. Well, we wanted sana to do it ang tahimik, papasok lang kami, but the problem is, yun pong aming equipment ay ganyan ang itsura. So, you cannot go inside the village and baka po sitahin sila ng security guards at magkaroon po ng security problem. So, we decided to just report that the villages didn't allow us inside. Now, for mobile in schools, out of the 19 schools we requested permission from, we've already conducted tests in 5. Yung pong iba ay hindi po nagbigay ng approval sa amin. And these are the results. Now, there is a good development. After the 700 megahertz was used by the telcos during the second to third quarter of 2016, we noticed a very high increase in long-term evolution speeds. Ano? For smart, this was done in Sampaloc, Santa Ana, in Manila, Quezon City, and San Juan City. Dito po yung malapit sa mga cell sites sila where they have LTE. The average speed measured in these areas is 27.48 Mbps, and the browsing rate is 100%. For Globe, the measurements done generally in Quezon City, specifically in Pansol, BF Homes, Holy Spirit, Mapayapa Village, and the areas of Commonwealth and Mindanao Avenues, the average speed measured is 33.41 Mbps. That's for mobile LTE. So you can see the improvement in LTE speeds that we're experiencing right now. And that's because we have unlocked the power of the 700 megahertz. Ito po ay ginagamit na ngayon at tuloy-tuloy po ang rollout ng ating mga telecommunications companies. In conclusion, there have been improvements in the quality of service delivered by the telcos. However, due to growing demand for high-speed broadband internet access, there is a need to increase the number of cell sites or base stations using this 700 megahertz. The broadband internet speed is higher as the user moves closer to the cell sites. Mas malapit po sa user ang cell site, mas mabilis at mas maganda po ang kanyang speed and experience. So sa madaling salita, kung mas marami po tayong cell sites, mas maganda po ito. We will discuss that later. Okay, to give you an indication of the current state of the internet in relation to other countries, I'd like to show you some global recent studies. Pero bago po yun, gusto ko lang po kayong bigyan ng isang realization. We always think that complaints on cellular mobile telephone service and internet speed and penetration is only limited to the Philippines. A cursory search in the internet will show that such complaints are very common in all corners of the world. Hindi lang po dito sa atin yan. Halos lahat po ng bansa ay may ganyan experience at may ganyan problem. Now, several items have quoted Akamai's latest findings, the third quarter of 2016. Akamai is an international private entity which measures internet speed using crowdsourcing. Its methodology makes use of people who download data using the Akamai crowdsourcing software. The latest report of Akamai is for the third quarter of 2016, where the Philippines did well in mobile but did not do so well in fixed internet. Based on the Akamai study, the Philippines' average connection speed for fixed line is 4.2 Mbps as shown in the Asia-Pacific table. We are second to the last in this cluster, dito po sa Asia-Pacific, just above India. For average connection speeds for mobile, the Philippines surprisingly was ranked number one in the Asia-Pacific cluster at 13.9 Mbps. Well, just a caveat, Akamai's measurement is akin to crowdsourcing. Its measuring device is embedded in the contents that it is hosting. So, this crowdsourcing means that the methodology, yun lang po ang nag-a-access sa content, yun lang po ang kanilang nakakapture. So, it is possible that many of those who access this content are those in the central business districts in urban areas. Baka po hindi nakakapture nito yung mga rural areas. So this may be a snapshot of our urban areas. So mas maganda po siguro, instead of just focusing on Akamai and other private entities po na gumagawa ng study, tignan din natin ang sinasabi ng mga international bodies. For example, the International Telecommunications Union, ang telecommunications body ng United Nations, or ITU, made a study which they do every 5 years. So this study is called the ICT Development Index. This study is composed of several factors, but one of the more important factors here is internet connectivity. In 2010, our IDI or ICT Development Index rank was 105. In 2015, we improved to number 98. So that would be a 7 steps na mas maganda. Another study, which was made by another international body, is the United Nations e-government survey. Ito pong e-government survey is also composed of several factors. But syempre, kasama din po dito ang connectivity and improvement in telecommunications. The Philippines is one of the 10 countries which improved on e-government performance. Our country ranked from number 95 to number 71, or an increase or improvement by 24 steps. When I mentioned this sa studies po in different sa mga fora that I attended, sabi po nila ng NTC ay gumanda ang internet. Ulitin ko lang po, I am just reading the results of tests that were done and surveys that were done by third parties. Hindi po ito gawa ng NTC at hindi po kami ang nagsasabi nito. We are just reading the results of their tests and surveys. Now, let's take a look at some comparative data on pricing naman. For pricing, there was a study made by Nambeo where comparative data price for fixed broadband, so fixed po ito, was listed. Translated into cost per Mbps, the Philippines is at 0.21 centavos per Mbps. Hindi rin po NTC ang may gawa nito. This was an international study done by Nambeo. I want you to know that for all the countries listed on the table, hindi po yung Philippines, the government spent for telecom infrastructure. Doon po sa mga bansa na nandyan, Myanmar, Malaysia, Cambodia, in one way or the other, the government intervened in telecom infrastructure. In the Philippines, mukhang ngayon lang po ito mangyayari. After the president approved the National Broadband Project, as presented by Secretary Salalima. As of now po kasi, all telecom infrastructure in the Philippines is owned and operated by the private sector. The slide is based on fixed broadband. The next slide is on mobile broadband, which also covers Southeast Asian countries. In terms of price, we are number 5 on the list. As mentioned a while ago, in all the other countries included in the list, telco infrastructure or infrastructure are partly or wholly financed by their governments. Sa atin po, ulitin ko lang, as of now, wala pa. But so far, I think we are doing well. Now let us go to pricing for mobile surfing based on another survey. Lumabas po ito only 2 weeks ago based on a study that was made that came out in Bloomberg, which was made by the analyst by the Universal Bank of Switzerland. This is actually a guide for investors na bumibili po ng stocks. So this is a very impartial study made by the analysts in the Universal Bank of Switzerland. Based on this survey, based on this study, the Philippines is the cheapest for mobile surfing. That is 10 cents of a dollar per MB of data volume. In Philippine pesos, that is around 5 pesos. In the same article, the analyst said, the Philippines is only a 2-player market as of now. But right now, they are killing each other in terms of pricing. So makikita po natin, competition is very much alive here in the Philippines. Makita niyo po, the highest is China, followed by Malaysia, India, Thailand, and Indonesia. Again, banggitin ko rin, In all these countries, the government has put in funds into infrastructure for telecommunications. In a study made, gumawa rin po kami ng sariling survey of all the promos and all the prices that were submitted to us by the telecommunications companies. This is for prepaid mobile services. We gathered all the promos and all the pricing po nila, and we took the average of the two telcos. Lumalabas po, the average price per one text is 0.04 centavos right now. Ang isang 3-minute call ay 0.16 centavos. Ang 1 MB na data ay 0.21 centavos. At ang isang oras ng pag-internet is 2.78 pesos. Now let us go to penetration. We did the speed. We already took a price. Now let's go to penetration. I will now discuss the penetration of telecommunication facilities in our country. Ito pong ginawa dito is based on the cell sites that they have, not necessarily coverage. Ibig po sabihin, kung meron silang presence in that particular area, kunwari po in one municipality, they have presence, but that does not mean that they are present in the whole municipality. It is possible na doon po sa central municipality where the majority of the people reside, ay doon po ay may signal because we don't have the capability to check hanggang doon kung saan po aabot ang signal. So this is based on cell site presence. So dito po sa globe, for 2G, they are present in 94.43% of all cities and municipalities in the Philippines. That's for 2G, that is text and call. For 3G naman po, text, call, and some internet, ay meron po silang presence in 92.47% of areas, cities, and municipalities around the country. For 4G, they are present in 62.48% of cities and municipalities around the Philippines. For fixed broadband, medyo mababa po tayo. For globe, that is only 22.28% of cities and municipalities in the Philippines. Let us now go to smart. For smart, sa 2G, they are present in 95.10% of the cities and municipalities around the Philippines. For 3G, they have 89.53% na coverage in all cities and municipalities. For 4G naman po, they are present in 32.44% cities and municipalities in the Philippines. But for the smart group, napakaganda po nitong kanilang fixed broadband. Ito po ay yung fixed na internet. That is, that they are present in 53.37% of cities and municipalities in the Philippines. Well, ang makakatulong po dito para patasin ang fixed broadband, ang fixed sa internet, ay yung pong National Broadband Plan which was approved by the President. Now, ang pinakamaganda pong summary to summarize these two tables sa mga figures na to ay yung pong survey that was made during the 2016 elections, national elections. During the 2016 elections, around 25% to 30% po ng public high schools and public elementary schools, yun po mga presinto kung saan nagkaroon ng elections, ay wala pong internet connection. They had to resort to satellite transmission. So that means 70 to 75% of these high schools and elementary schools have some form of internet connectivity, whether it is fixed or mobile. And on the end, 25 to 30% po ang wala. But I would also like to mention that during the survey done in the 2010 presidential elections, ang meron lang po noon ay 53% of high schools and elementary schools. That means, nadagdagan po siya ng 25% or almost 50% of 50%. So that is an improvement for the past 6 years. Now, well, I gave you the statistics that we have on pricing, speed, penetration. Punta naman po tayo sa challenges that are being faced by the telecoms industry. Well, first of all, I would like you to know that the regulator, the NTC, is really pushing hard para gumanda po ang ating serbisyo. But we need help from Congress. Because right now, the Commonwealth Act or the Public Service Act of 1936 ang amin pong ginagamit para sa penalties against the telecommunications companies. Section 21 of the Public Service Act of 1936 provides that every public service violating or failing to comply with the terms and conditions of any certificate of and or any orders, decisions, or regulations of the Commission is subject to fine of not exceeding 200 pesos. Ulitin ko lang po, 200 pesos for every day during which such default or violation continues. And the Commission is hereby authorized or empowered to impose such fine after due notice and hearing. This is a 1936 law, and it has not been amended or improved since 1936. Halos lahat po sigurito sa atin na hindi pa, well, I think it is safe to say na lahat ng nandito ngayon present ay hindi pa pinapanganak noong 1936. But right now, that is the law that we are using. A fine of 200 pesos is too low and does not deter telecommunications entities from violating the terms and conditions of their authorities. Kasama na po yung orders, decisions, or regulations of the Commission. Now, we may be curious, magkano po ba ang 200 pesos in present value? We requested the NEDA to help us kung magkano na po yung 200 pesos ngayon, ngayong 2016. Based on NEDA estimates, it is at 1,076,337 pesos. That is the value of 200 pesos in 1936 dito po sa present natin. Ito po ang value na dapat na ipinapataw namin sa mga telcos. Now the problem is, this is a penalty clause and it has to be amended first bago po namin maipataw ang ganyang amount. So it is recommended that a new law should be enacted increasing the fines that the Commission can impose on our stakeholders. Fortunately, Senator Bam Aquino filed a bill increasing the fine to a minimum of 300,000 to a maximum of 500,000 for every day per violation during which such default or violation continues. Sa lower house naman po, Congressman Victor Yap of Tarlac filed a similar bill. We really need this law to be passed para magkaroon po kami ng basis para magpataw ng mataas-taas at acceptable na fines and penalties. Let us now go to the next challenge that we are facing. These are the permits from the local government units. Since last year, media has pointed out that there is a problem with regard to LGU permits. Our telcos are having a difficult time rolling out in the countryside and in cities. This issue first came out during our hearings with the Committee of Senator Bam Aquino in the Senate, and we are now trying to find a solution to this problem. Tower Exchange is a company which provides tower services in other countries. In Feb 2016, Tower Exchange survey showed that the Philippines only has 15,000 cell sites while other countries have so much. Makikita nyo naman po, China has more than 1 million, India 400,000, and so on down the line. Please remember that the Philippines is an archipelago, thus the need to build more cell sites. So what is the problem regarding the LGU permits? The permits needed by a telco company to be able to put up a cell site is around 25 to 30. Konti lang po ang sa national government. The average processing time, according to our telcos, is around 8 months, and the building of the actual cell site takes around 3 months. So collectively, that is already 11 months for the permits and for the construction. By the time that you put up your cell site, oras na naman po para magpa-renew. That is, if the permit is actually given or released or approved. Marami na pong nangyayari na hindi po natatapos yung permit na yan. So nakapending po siya. For example, one telco mentioned during a Senate hearing that they had a budget in 2015 for 1,000 cell sites. Yung pong pera na yan ay handa ng gastusin to build and construct 1,000 cell sites. But approved permits that were granted to them was only for less than 50% of that. Mga 400 plus lang po ang kanilang nakuha na permits for 2015. So what is the result? They were only able to build less than 50% of the budget that they allotted. Another issue about the LGU permits is that the range of fees being charged ay masyado pong varied. There are LGUs that require telcos to pay 5,000 pesos for tower permits. Meron din pong 150,000, meron din pong 500,000 or more. Actually, what happened was the local government code devolved to the local government units yung pagsingil at pagdetermine ng fees na yan. The phrase used in the local government code is reasonable fees. So what does reasonable fees mean? That is the question. That is something that we have to put a standard on. Moving forward, how do we plan to fix this LGU permit problems? The first thing that we did was Secretary Sela Lima gave an order to the National Telecommunications Commission to prepare a draft executive order limiting the processing time of permits in the local government level to 3 days. Meron pong process yan, and that executive order will be presented tomorrow. The EO is for the signature, for the review of the Office of the President, and for the signature of the President, if they so agree. We also talked to the DALG. Ang aming pong kausap ay si Yusek Oster Panadero and the National Competitiveness Council. Ang kasama po namin is Mr. Bill Luz. They both agreed that expediting permits for telecommunications be part of the competitiveness of an LGU since this highlights connectivity. Gagamitin po siya sa competitiveness index ng mga LGUs. Chairman Bill Luz of the NCC will be discussing this action more thoroughly later on. With the plan, the LGUs will be asked to lower the number of permits required and to shorten the process. Yung pong may pinakamagandang proseso at may pinakamaiksi na proseso ay magkakaroon po ng mataas na index for connectivity competitiveness. Fully supportive of the endeavor, the telcos agreed that they will enter these areas if those with the lower telecom connectivity index to fast-track the rollout. This in turn will help progress and development in that particular LGU, making the area more attractive for investors. Now to address the issue on fees. There will be a memorandum of agreement that will be signed by the BLGF or the Bureau of Local Government Finance under the DOF. Ang aming pong katulong dyan ay si Executive Director Tan. That is the Bureau, together with the DILG, the DICT, and NTC, that will create a technical working group which will generate a study for the issuance of a joint memorandum circular that will standardize ito pong fees that are being charged ng mga local government units sa ating mga telcos. Having a standard is necessary to ensure that the spectrum of fees is deemed reasonable by all the parties concerned. Okay, isa na naman pong issue babanggitin ko rin is that one being faced by our telcos in rolling out the infrastructure, our Homeowners Association. Right now, under the existing law, Homeowners Association should give their consent before a cell site or a telco infra or infrastructure is put up inside their village or subdivision. Kaya lang po, most or majority or almost all of this Homeowners Association do not give permits. Kaya po, walang cell site or telecom infrastructure inside our villages. Napakarami po nito. The problem is, ayaw po nila magpapasok ng telco cell sites or infrastructure. But the people who live in these villages are the first ones to complain kapag wala pong magandang connectivity. I want to give you the list. Ito po ang mga humindi na sa pagbigay ng permits. But there are still those that are pending na hindi pa humihindi, but most likely ay ganun din po ang maging resulta. Ito po yung mga outright denial. That's for Smart. That's the list of Smart. It's so hard to make it big because there's so much number of villages. Ang dami po niyan. For globe naman, ganun din. Now try to picture this. Ayala Alabang is composed of 700 hectares. And there is only one cell site inside Ayala Alabang. Imagine the volume that the single cell site has to serve. All those living inside Ayala Alabang are only relying on this one single cell site. Ganun din po ang Forbes Park, 250 to 300 hectares. Las Marinas Village is also 300 to 400 hectares. Wala pong cell site inside those two villages. In all the Valle Verdes, in all the Green Meadows, wala rin pong cell sites inside. But sad to say, we receive so much complaints from residents residing in these villages. Clearly, there is a lack of connectivity and service inside these villages, and the people who live there are heavy data users. You can also imagine the complaints that we receive from the people who reside there. But the problem is their homeowners association do not allow the installation of cell sites. Isa pa po, 15 to 20 years ago, condominium developments started to become residences of people. A cell site can serve maybe 5 to 10 floors, aabutin po niya. Higher than that, hirap na po ang signal na abutin. A lot of condominiums right now are higher than 10 floors. So isipin po ninyo, how can a cell site just located at a street level, paano po niya masaservice those who are living from the 15th floor to the 60th floor of most of our condominium units and office buildings? The problem with them is they don't have indoor building solutions while being constructed. And after being put up, the condominium corporation eventually does disallow such provisions. Hindi po sila din pumapayag, katulad po ng mga homeowners associations. What happens here is that provisions for such solutions, like pico cells, will be laid out by doing renovations on existing structures. Dadaan po tayo sa ceiling or sa kisame at magsisira po tayo. The problem is condominium corporations become hesitant to accommodate these physical changes. So napakahirap pong gawin kapag natapos na ang isang condominium, residential building or office building, para lagyan po sila ng indoor building solutions. Moving forward, how do we solve these problems on homeowners and villages at yung po mga condominiums? For homeowners association, their primary consideration is the supposed health hazard or radiation emitted by cell sites. Addressing these issues, the DICT and NTC and the Department of Health, lumapit po kami sa Department of Health at nagpatulong po sa kanila. Ang kanila pong representative here, ang tumutulong po sa amin, ay si Assistant Secretary Agnet Peralta. Ma'am, thank you very much. We collaborated with the DOH, and we brought into the country an Australian expert from the International Commission on Non-Ionizing Radiation Protection, or ICNIRP. Dr. Rodrick Koff, later today, will give a short lecture on why having a cell site inside villages is actually safe para po sa atin. Even the exposure of pico cells inside condominiums is considered safe. The DOH ay nag-issue na po ng certification to this effect. And actually, nanalo na po ang DOH sa Court of Appeals. Sinabi po ng Court of Appeals in a decision na tama po ang opinion ng Department of Health. But we also wanted an international and non-government organization to expert view on this. Kaya po, inimbita po namin si Dr. Croft. We also have drafted some legislation for utility spaces for telecoms infrastructure in subdivisions and villages. Ito po ay isa sa output ng ating summit. We'll be presenting this tomorrow during the afternoon session. In the draft bill, we would like that for new villages, sa mga bago lang naman po ito, when a subdivision plan or a village plan is submitted to the HLURB or Housing and Land Use Regulatory Board, a space for utilities would already include a space for cell sites or telco infrastructure. This means that if you are buying a property sa bagong village, hindi po sa mga dati dahil tapos na po yon, you are already aware that you are buying a property near a cell site. This way, we may forgo the homeowners association's consent. Ito po ay for new villages lang, ulitin ko. For buildings and condominiums, well, ang katulong po namin sa HLURB ay ang Commissioner Goles Cabrera. She has been helping us ever since on this item. Ngayon sa condominium corporations naman po, condominiums and buildings, dapat po before they get an approval for a building permit, there should already be indoor building solutions for mobile communications and fiber optic cabling para po sa internet. Hindi po siya after itayo yung building. It should be before, nandun na po siya at in place. Ang katulong po namin dito is the DPWH, because all the building officials ay under them. And DPWH right now is doing a study at nag-iikot po sila on how to amend the building code. Ito po ang aming contribution to that effort. Undersecretary Karen Jimenez, the one helping us from the DPWH. Another issue that we have is that in DPWH, in 2014, issued an order. Yun pong prohibited uses within the right-of-way of national roads. This was a reaction to the typhoons that we experienced because the DPWH had a hard time restoring yung pong mga roads that were damaged by typhoons, because nandun din po yung electric poles, yung water, utilities, at yung pong mga telco facilities tulad ng fiber optic network. So, the department order issued by the DPWH ay pinagbawal po ang paglagay ng fiber optics doon sa mga national roads. But that's very hard for us dahil po, paano po tayo magro-roll out? So what we did is we talked to the DPWH and they agreed to sign a memorandum of agreement establishing a technical working group to review this department order. They are doing one right now with the electric cooperatives, and tayo naman po ang kasunod dun sa effort na yon. And they agreed that it's important that right-of-way should include telecommunications facilities. Right now, if you look at the results of our fixed broadband benchmarking at yung pong coverage, ay there is much improvement na ating pong kailangan gawin. Marami po tayong kailangan gawin at kailangan po itong pagandahin para sa kabutihan ng ating bansa. First of all, we are an archipelago, so it is so hard to put up that national broadband network. Secondly, almost all countries have spent so much funds for national broadband for telecommunications infrastructure of their countries. Dahil nakikita po nila that if you increase your internet speed at iyong pong internet penetration, there is a corresponding increase in their GDP. So to increase the GDP, ay tinaas po nila ang kanilang penetration at speed. So just to give you some examples of what they did, isipin nyo po ang Singapore, in 1998, that was almost 10 years ago, started the National Fiber Optic Network Project. And Singapore is not such a big country. They say that in Singapore, there is no domestic flight. Pero they still did this. The project is called Singapore One. It is a government initiative for the operation and maintenance of the national broadband network. Government funds were used for this. For Malaysia, the National Broadband Plan for Malaysia was developed in 1998. And in 2004, the government of Malaysia approved the National Broadband Plan, and then the government funded the development of the national broadband network. It is operated by Telecom Malaysia, which is 80% owned by the government of Malaysia. So makikita po natin, it's also a government initiative. Another example is Thailand. Ang Thailand po ay na-approve ang kanilang national broadband policy in 2006. The Thai government is investing $1.1 billion to enhance the national broadband network of Thailand. So these are just some examples. I can stay here for a very long time and enumerate all those countries that injected funds into this national broadband network. Yun po kasing broadband network, they're looking at it like a road. Instead of the people traveling through the road, lalagyan na lang po natin sila ng broadband dun sa kanilang mga areas. And instead of them working all in Manila, at nagsisiksikan po tayo dito, ilalabas po natin ang development at work sa countryside. Imagine if there are so many BPOs outside the Metro Manila, the people in the countryside would be able to earn as much as the people here in Manila, but they will be spending their money there. So napakaganda po noon for economic activities in the countryside. Sa atin po, buti na lang, the President Rodrigo Duterte, during this first State of the Nation address, he mandated the DICT and its attached agencies to formulate the National Broadband Plan and to implement it. And we are very happy to say that the DICT, spearheaded by our Secretary Salalima, ay natapos na itong National Broadband Plan. At lumabas na po ang news, binanggit nila kanina, ulitin ko lang din, masarap kasing ulitin, that the President approved the Philippine National Broadband Plan and nasa DICT na po ito for implementation. With all our efforts na binanggit ko kanina to help the private sector, yung pong ating mga telcos, at ito pong forthcoming implementation of the National Broadband Plan, mukhang gaganda po at bibilis at kakalat ang connectivity sa Pilipinas. Maraming salamat po.